For those of you who are used to see me from my home, you can see I'm in a different environment.
My home.
Yes. And we're going to start with kind of introductory notes that I'm going to make as short as possible so that we can enjoy the full hour with Yair Nitzani, whom I'm very excited to be in conversation with and sharing this conversation with you today. Notes. So it's Wednesday, June 22, 10 a.m. Pacific time, 1 p.m. Eastern, and 8 p.m. in Israel. Just a few notes. June to August is CSP's 22nd annual fundraising drive. You can see membership levels and benefits, new CSP member only area with access to video, special content, context, etc. In our website. I'm going to drop it in the chat in a moment. And also June to August is CSP hat logo wear challenge. You can wear your CSP logoed item this summer, send in your picture and win prizes. You can check all this out, one moment, at this link. Oh. Today, I'm in conversation with Yair Nitzani. I was looking at the topic and I kind of just wrote for myself about everything because this is extremely exciting and I'll talk more and when I introduce Yair, but yeah, our topic is everything. this is CSP online program number 452. You can see a list of our upcoming programs in this month as well as upcoming month on our website, www.occsp.net. And some upcoming events this Thursday, which is tomorrow, will be the third part of the Jewish adventure to Baltoskandia. I never know how to pronounce that, with Evgenia Kempinski. Part three will take you to Estonia, the singing nation. And on Sunday, June 26th at 4 p.m., Seth Rogovoy will be presenting and talking and singing about the essential klezmer, Jewish roots and soul music from the old world to the jazz age, to the downtown avant-garde. And so we come to introduce Yair Nitzani. Hello. Known as the Israeli Jon Stewart, Yair Nitzani is a musician, writer, comic, and TV personality. Nitzani uses satire and comedy to present his distinctive take on life, fusing cynicism with endless optimism, moving forward while yearning for the good old times, and balancing his career in music production with the tribulations of being an 80s rock star. In recent years, Yair has entertained audiences all over Israel with his intimate and intelligent comedy. He is the host of the weekly television culture show A Bit High and previously hosted the television show Yanshufim, for which he won award for the best TV show in 2011 and 2012. From 2003 to 2005, Nitzani wrote and hosted three seasons of Ahorei HaChadashot, or Behind the News, which was nominated for Best Entertainment Show of the Year. In the past, Yael has also joined the judges of Kohav Nolad, the Israeli version of American Idol. He is the writer of a popular satirical column, Raising an Eyebrow, in the daily Hebrew language newspaper, Israel Hayom, and which led to the publication of a successful book by the same name. You mm-hmm. want to show them the work?
Oh, yeah.
Yair also supports a program for lone Israeli soldiers that was founded by his wife, Drorit Nitzani. Mm-hmm. So when I said we'll be talking about everything, you can understand why. And I think what we're going to try to do in this conversation is kind of take junctions from Yair's life. And in many ways, they open doors to moments, unique moments within Israeli culture and history in very surprising ways. So we're going to start by sharing this clip or part of it. We're going to listen to a few minutes and then talk about it.
Okay. That was me.
She cracks it up, so she's having a fun.
Oh, I didn't mean to do that. One moment. So, Yair, let's, you said this is you, and it is. Let's find the image of you. One moment.
I was the guy with the white jacket, with the faucet on my head, with full hair. This one, that's me, with a beard. And that was 1981, 41 years ago. I was in my 20s then, and we had a group called Tislam, which we started actually in the army radio station, Galei Tzahal, it's called in Israel. And we were a few guys who served in the army radio station, and we started formed the group, and we became very successful in Israel with gold and platinum albums. You can see them behind me. And then we split, and then we came back. And
so before you split, I mean, I'm sure everyone noticed that this clip I just showed is in English.
Is in English, yeah.
So how did that happen? Why did it all start in English?
Well, because the first deal that we got was from Sweden, a record company from Sweden who decided to release our music. And they wanted us to do songs in English. So we started recording music in English. So we wrote songs in English and we recorded them and then released them in Sweden and then in Canada and in South Africa. Nothing really happened with those recordings in out of Israel. But actually, the mixing process of this album was made in Los Angeles, actually. And we went to a studio called Cherokee in Los Angeles, in Fairfax. And we mixed it there with lots of mega stars around us, Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers and the Cars and other guys. So we were lucky to be in the center of the making of serious music.
And was the music created, I mean, the words I know in Hebrew, which we'll hear in a moment in the next clip, did you write them first in English and then translate, or first in Hebrew and then?
Some and some. Some of the songs were recorded, written in English first and then translated to Hebrew, and others were translated from Hebrew to English. Depends on the song.
Okay, and this one specifically?
Was written in English.
Written in English, yeah, and translated. I never knew that. This is a song basically anyone in Israel, I
think. It's a big hit. Yeah.
It's a huge hit. We're going to hear a couple of minutes of this song in Hebrew. And you can see here, Yair Nitzani, can you show them? This is kind of his trademark.
Oh, yeah. This is a faucet that I got from a magic shop in the States, I think. It costs nothing, $2 or $5 or whatever. But the trick is that they have here a vacuum sticker, and actually it can stick to anything. I decided to stick it on my head. And you have to understand that while I did it, the first time I did this on television without telling anybody, the country went berserk. Everybody wanted to see who is that stupid guy with a faucet on his head. And since then, that was in 1981, since then there's not a day that somebody's not coming to me and saying, where is the faucet? Where do you put the faucet? Where is it? What do you have it on you now? Can you show me? 40 years, it's still my brand tool. And it's a funny thing.
And I think when Yair says the country went berserk, there's an interesting thing. We talked about how Yair is the intersection of so many things. It's possible because Israel is so tiny. So, I mean, not to take away from your greatness, but also in such a tiny country, yes, when something like this, and you can see, we're going to see this clip, you can see the symbol. This was the only TV channel. There wasn't another channel. Everyone watched this. So you can understand how widespread it was. We're going to hear a little bit of this song. We just heard the beginning in English, and we're going to hear it now in Hebrew.
Hebrew, okay. That is so. What did they say? So young.
Everyone is very young and has hair.
This girl is Milia Vitali.
Yeah, she's actually a famous actress. Here she's very young. This in favor. So we're going to start with this song. We're going to start with the recording. And then...
Oh. That's not mine, is it?
That's not mine.
Okay,
it's
I'll
yours.
Stop it, yeah.
So we'll start with the recording and then Yair will play for us live once we find...
Where
the phone is.
Yeah, I know. I found it. Yeah.
He found it. Okay.
Sorry about that.
It gave me a moment there's a question here about Kaveret. We're going to keep it for later. Absolutely relevant. But we're going to start this song. We're going to start it as it was screened or showed on television in 93. Actually, a decade after your band kind of came apart,
yeah,
right? And how come you're performing here on TV?
Yeah, we did a reunion tour in the 90s. And since then, basically, we still continue and perform. So we're now very active. We had the 40th anniversary last year. And we had many, many shows, and we still have. And I have a show on Saturday, and I have a show on Thursday. So still very active. Maybe you should say something about the other camera, that we have another camera, if they want to see us.
Yeah, you can choose your point of view. We have here two cameras, very sophisticated. So you can choose how to view it. We're going to start this song viewing the clip, but then Yair is gonna just come in live so we get to hear him singing and playing the music as we're listening. No, that's not what I wanted to do. Okay. The clip has random subtitles. It's an old clip. I'm gonna make this fade out for you to you're going nostalgic. You're supposed to play the music.
This song is basically about Israel, about Kinneret, the Golan, and all kinds of views of the country. But it had some hidden messages inside, talking about war also and stuff like that.
So, yeah, so most of your music was like, I'd say not political, engaged with the country, with the views, with the people, a rock band. And then we have this song that came a little later, and it's very, very different. what we're going to do, I'm going to show you, this is actually from a performance. The date you're seeing here isn't of the performance, it's of when this song came out.
Exactly.
Notice it came out in 1990, which is much, it's after the group fell apart. So,
exactly.
And it's very different in many ways from your other songs. Can you say a word or two about where this performance... and I'll just say, notice that for those, I am sharing the screen, but we have another camera, so you can choose if you want to see Yair full view, rather than share the screen, you can play between them.
Okay,
but,
somebody wrote Chatzavim Porchim in Hebrew, so it's Nurit, who probably speaks Hebrew. Hi, Nurit, Mashlomer. So this recording, this clip is made in Rishon LeZion, a few years ago with the Symphonic Orchestra of Rishon LeZion, which is a huge orchestra of 70 musicians. And you know, every rock group wants to perform with a big orchestra because, you know, we have lots of complexes as being rock musicians. We want to play with the real musicians. So it took us 10 years to find an orchestra that agreed to play with us. And I always asked... the conductor who was helping us in this, Ilan Mukhiach, a very famous conductor, I said to him, Ilan, why doesn't any orchestra want to play with us? So he says, because you're doing a lot of noise. You're making a lot of noise. So what we did is we convinced our drummer, who is a very noisy drummer, to play on pads, drums, with earphones. So he played like crazy, very noisy, but only he could hear himself. So this is the concert in Rishon LeZion a few years ago with the Symphonic Orchestra of Rishon LeZion.
So we're going to hear a couple minutes from this and then actually talk about the lyrics of the song, which are quite a diversion from the usual songs.
Why did fossil versus anything else. Okay.
So what we prepared for you is a translation of a bit, just a few words of this song. And again, Yair, if you can talk to that camera and then people can see some of the lyrics while they're seeing you. But the song is very different from...
The usual pop song.
So can
It was 1990. I don't remember exactly what was happening in the country. Some kind of stink, political stink, and we were rehearsing the big comeback of 1990, and we had this melody. And I went home to write the lyrics, and I just the lyrics flew out of me. And the song was released and was a huge success because it was talking about some kind of a politician or guy who is around, behind politicians, some kind of corrupted guy who is into the nitty-gritty of stuff and how he knows everything, how he knows everybody, how he controls the situation. He decides things about education, about war, about going to war and stuff like that. And he's like the face of the country, Parzufa shel Hamdina. And the song became very successful and very relevant then, and stayed relevant for 30 years. And every time there's something happening in the politics of Israel, they play the song on the radio.
And I think one of the interesting things is that you don't take sides in this song. It's unclear what political side.
Yeah, that's on purpose, of course. We didn't want to take sides. We wanted to say that those guys who run our lives, some of them are corrupted, and it doesn't matter from which side they are. That's what we wanted to show. So this is the translation.
I think that whoever wanted to read it could kind of look at it. And we're actually moving kind of, this is, I'd say, almost a transition between your career in music and career in satire and comedy. We're gonna show some of this clip that you based another song on and hear the story behind it. Do you want the story first?
Yeah, I'll tell you part of the story.
So I'm just going to stop share.
Okay. So basically, we had a radio show called Mayesh, some kind of slang in Hebrew. And it was on the IDF radio station, the Galei Tzahal, the army radio station. I was already out of the band. I was working in a record company as an executive in the record company.
Warner Brothers. It's the record company.
it's the representative of Warner Brothers in Israel, actually. And I was in that period running the company already. On my spare time, I was doing all kinds of sketches and stuff with those guys in the radio station. And one of the special shows was Yom Ha'atzmaut, the Independence Day show, and they asked me to write a special song for Yom Ha'atzmaut. So I wrote about the fact that we Israelis love to go take the car on Friday or Saturday and go to the closest actually park, which might be, you know, in the middle of Tel Aviv, and do a barbecue. And the song is about the family that does that barbecue in the middle of Tel Aviv. It became a huge hit, and we were invited, of course, to go on television with the song and on Friday night, and the song became very known as the Yom Ha'atzmaut song, because everybody is when doing barbecue, they sing that song. You have to take in mind that we were off tune on purpose.
Yeah, you're gonna hear. Yeah, we were like completely off tune, but it's on purpose.
And the song originally is a German song, which was very popular in the 80s in Israel. We took the music and put Israeli Hebrew lyrics on it. So,
did you get the rights to do that?
Yes, yes. Oh, I'm okay. The official translator. Oh. Of this song, which has, well, I'll tell you the story afterwards.
Okay, so we're going to see first just a few seconds from the
original.
The original, and then we're gonna see Yael's version.
So tacky.
Yeah. Okay. I think you get the idea.
Two tacky guys from Germany singing in high voices. Now the parody is different. That's me. I'll hold you up.
You wanted to tell us
story. So the original of this song, the German guys were very, very popular in Israel. The record company that I managed used to distribute their records in Israel, and we sold hundreds of thousands of copies in Israel, which is a lot in Israel. And this year, we're talking 86 or something, I was going to Cannes to the record industry festival where all the record companies from all around the world meet. And I met the managers of this group, a record company from Germany. And this woman comes to me and says, "Hi, Yair. Dieter is the guy that sang the song. Dieter, come. I would like you to meet Yair from Head Arts Records in Israel. Yair is responsible for the success that we have in Israel with Modern Talking, the group." So this guy comes and says, "Hi, Yair, how are you? Thank you very much for the work that you are doing for us in Israel." And then she says, "You know, Dieter, that Yair also recorded a cover version of Brother Louis, the song in Hebrew. And believe it or not, the song is a big hit." So this guy says to me, "Oh, really? So what are the lyrics about?" So I didn't want to tell him that the lyrics are about a guy doing a barbecue, and it's a funny takeoff on their song. So I said to him, "It's an exact translation of your song." That's how I managed to run away from the embarrassment.
Did he ever find out?
I don't think so.
No. So we're moving forward.
Any questions?
In time. Well, we'll get to questions.
We'll get to questions.
We're kind of going in a weird twist and turn, more as your role as producer with this crazy, crazy story. Maybe I'll play a few
notes
of this so they understand how far the music is from your own.
All
and
right.
Then you can tell us how
this
happened.
Such a beautiful voice. Okay, so the story goes like this. I was in the record company, not managing the record company. I was in low position that year. I just started. And one of the projects that I got from my bosses was to promote the Yemenite album by Ofra Chaza. Ofra Chaza is a Yemenite girl who was very famous and very successful in Israel in the 80s. And she did this project of Yemenite songs as a present to her parents. And I didn't know what to do with that because it was very uncommercial. And what I did is I took the recording and we went to the studio with Israel Ashdod and a few other friends of mine. and we started remixing it and making it a dance version. And it's a very long story, but the end of it is that this remix became huge all over the world and started basically the movement of what they call world music. And the records of Afro Chaza were sold all over the world by millions. And sadly enough, she died of AIDS 20 years ago. And it's a big loss for the Israeli music business. But she managed to have a great career all over the world and recorded with Michael Jackson, Paul Anka, and many others, and performed all over the world. And she was a big success. And everything started actually from that song that we started with the Yemenite music.
And how did you have the nerve to remix her music?
Well, first of all, I asked permission of her and her manager. And they agreed, and then we started to play with it, you know, and it became the blend between the Yemenite music and the rock and the pop, and everything together made it a very successful record. And it was number one in Germany and Italy and France and Spain and Portugal and all the Benelux countries. It was huge, huge.
So we're going to listen to a few minutes from the remix, and then I'm going to ask you a few more questions about what happened to it in Israel.
Okay. Okay,
so
she's beautiful. She has an amazing voice. She was very talented, very unique personality, and it's a big loss for everybody.
Can I ask you how this was received in Israel? Because she was number one in all these countries. It was selling by millions. What happened here?
In the beginning, there was no reaction at all. But when it started to succeed all over the world, the media started writing about it. And they understood that something very big is happening here. But in the beginning, they didn't like it so much because Ofer wasn't cool. She wasn't the cool rock artist that was accepted by media, by the music business. She was too commercial, and suddenly this commercial girl is making it all over the world as nobody else did before. So it was difficult.
Yeah, she wasn't part of the milieu.
Exactly.
I mean, if you remember when we spoke, your group started from that radio station you all worked in. There's, mm-hmm. It's very, very close-knit.
Exactly.
And she was an outsider.
Nachon.
That find it kind of hard to enter the mainstream.
Although she was very successful, but not in the right milieu.
Why, can you say a few words about the right milieu?
Well, first of all, you know, it's the kind of music that she did, which was very different than what we played to you, because her music was very commercial, very poppy, very Europoppy. And suddenly we came with something very different. And secondly, I don't know, maybe it's a racial thing also, you know, she was Yemenite, and maybe the Ashkenazi media guys didn't like it. I'm not sure about this, but maybe.
Okay. Before we move on, I'm just going to mention what I forgot to mention at the beginning, that this program is dedicated in honor of Craig and Bridget Frankel, a longtime CSP donors.
And Frankel also. My mother was Frankel.
Huh.
Yeah.
Okay. So dedicated
Hello,
to
Greg.
Them. Hi, Craig. We're seeing you right now.
Now we're family, Greg.
So moving on. We're moving basically to
television.
To television, to your career in satire and television. This show, Ahorei HaChadashot, Behind the News.
Yeah, it's actually, it's if you want to be specific, it's not Behind the News, it's the Behind of the News.
Yes.
when you translate the Ahorei HaChadashot.
Yeah, it's like the arse of the news.
Exactly. So it's a weekly show on Channel 10 that doesn't exist anymore. It became 14 and then whatever. And it was a weekly political show. It's very close to what Jon Stewart is doing. And it was a funny show and I liked it a lot. We had three or four seasons. And the sherry on top was this thing that we're going to show you, which was a weekly thing, sketch, that was what we call the strange workers, which is some kind of a translation of the word of Dim Zarin.
Yeah, maybe I'll say in a moment, because I think it's interesting. You go in the sketch, it's a lot of play on Hebrew and English, so maybe I'll explain that even a little more so it's more understood. So in Hebrew, migrant workers or foreign workers will be called Ovdim Zarim, which is interesting. It leans into Avodah Zarah,
exactly.
Idolatry in Hebrew. It depends, like in the same way that in English you can say migrant workers or foreign workers and it kind of gives away your political stance. So in Hebrew you can say Ovdim Zarim or Mehagrei Avodah. Ovdim Zarim, foreign workers leaning into idolatry and Avodah Zarah, or Mehagrei Avodah, migrant workers, that actually comes from the root of Hagar and immigration that goes to a much more positive direction.
But what we did is we took the word Zarim, and if you take the word Zarim and Muzarim, which are strange people, Muzarim, we made it Ovdim Zarim, strange workers.
Okay.
So this was really funny. And we were talking in English to those guys, broken English. And those foreign workers were looking at me. I was explaining to them about Judaism, about Israel, about the holidays and stuff like that. And they were thinking, wow, this guy is totally crazy.
So we're going to see a short sketch of this. You'll hear Yair's broken English, which is basically kind of a lot of it is play on words, but I think you'll get most of it.
Okay.
Hello and good evening to all the strange workers. Today I will explain why you should thank Jesus you are not Jewish. Of days, you will celebrate your New Year's Eve, and I have to admit, you Christians play there. Your holidays are much more fun. You celebrate happy events like birth, love, dead saints, and we celebrate in Pesach the drowning of the Egyptians in the Red Sea and the killing of all their firstborn. In Purim, Kippurim, you know, hanging Persians on trees, and Hanukkah, killing Greek people on elephants, you know, to show the lies, we like catastrophes, persecutions, and massacres. We have a leader that walked on water. We don't have a leader. Nothing works because there's no water. New Year parties, you know, counting down from 10 to 0, and then boom, fireworks, champagne, kisses on the mouth. Our countdown is counting stars in the sky to see if the Shabbat or Chag is out, and if it's okay to go buy cigarettes and eat something little. You have nice, simple songs like, we wish you a Merry Christmas, we wish you a Merry Christmas, we wish you a Merry Christmas and Happy New Year. And we spill your mother-in-law on the non-Jews. And in every generation, people are standing on our boats to tell me later. These are our songs. You have Santa Claus in every toy store, generously giving nicely wrapped presents, wearing a beautiful red gown. And we have Eliyahu the prophet, who is an alcoholic, nobody ever saw, dressed in shmates, demands his own glass, doesn't bring any presents, and for him to come, you have to leave the door open because he's so drunk, he might bang his head at the door. We also envy your calendar because ours is too complicated. After February, when February is finally over, we suddenly discover that it's a pregnant year, and it's February again. What can I say? He was a smart guy, your Jesus. He took our boring Jewish religion and deproved it, and now you have all the fun. But still, we were here first. We invented God on our side. Week, I will explain why we cut our baby's penis 8 days after he was born and why we give him wine so he will not cry. Thank you very much.
Okay. I'm not sure you got it, but there's a few of those in the internet. You can see them on YouTube. One of them is the problem with the Jewish. Why there are three kinds of Jews, basic, I mean, regular Jews, medium Jews, very, very Jews, etc. So go look for it.
We'll be sending the links for you to see. And actually, we're transitioning now to a whole different side of you. We mentioned it a little bit in the bio. We're going to see 3.5 minutes of this. I think you're going to all notice the twist and turn we just took, and then we're going to hear about this project.
There's a translation.
And yeah, this one is with English translation, so quite easy to follow.
את הג'יפים שקרה את הלילה ביער בין שמן ישבו עשרות צעירים וצעירות רבים מהם מעולם לא היו בטיול כזה למרות שעברו כבר את גיל 20
בילדות, לא היה לי בכלל את הדבר הזה נוסע עם ג'יפים את כל האחרים, המשפחה לא היה להם רכב ולבוא לעשות את המסע הזה אחרי השחרור מהצבא בהחלט זה מרגש
כולם פה חיילים משוחררים, כולם גם חיילים בודדים. למרות שאף אחד מהם לא עולה חדש, כאן בטיול שהבינו להם, הם שותפות הגורל.
אני נורא מתרגשת לטיול הזה בכללי. אני לא רוצה להעתיק אותם הרבה תהליך בודדים. והיה לי חשוב למצוא אנשים שהם מבינים את המצב שלי.
בכלל הרגשתי מאוד לבד. בעצם שהגעתי לפה והתחלתי להכיר, הרגשתי מאוד מחוברת אליהם, וזה מאוד נגע בי.
בסוף המסלול מחכה לה נרגשת יחד עם המשפחה של דרורית ניצני, שהקימה את המרכז לחיילים בודדים ישראלים, לא דמיינה שזה מה שיהיה. אני חושב שעד לא מזמן לא הכירה שום חייל בודד.
Yeah.
מוזר מה שכן.
לא, ציון.
מלא שמיע.
חמש שנים שאלי סופר מרגיש חלק בלתי נפרד ממשפחת ניצן. מאז שדרורית, יאיר והבנות פתחו לו את הדלת, שהחייל בודד במצוקה.
אני מרגיש בבית. איך שאני הגעתי, ישר הרגשתי בבית. הגיע לי פה מתי שאני רוצה, יש לי מפתח. עושה מה שאני רוצה. כאילו נולדתי מחדש לפני חמש שנים.
הוא נולד לפני 26 שנה בירושלים, הילד ה-11 מתוך 12 ילדים. גדל בבית של הורים חרדים, חוזרים בתשובה.
לא יודע, אני מרגיש כל הזמן סגור. תמיד הייתי, כל זה ניסיתי לברוח, כל זה ניסיתי לצאת, הייתי ילד מאוד בעייתי. יום אחד, חזיתי שאני הולך ולא חוזר.
כמה הייתה?
הייתי בגיל 13.
כשאני מסתובב ברחובות, עד שבגיל 18 החליט שהוא מתגייס, הכי קרבי שאפשר ליחידת מגלן. הגיוס ניתק אותו עוד יותר מהמשפחה, והוא הוכר כחייל בודד. הוא לחם במבצע צוק איתן ונפצע ברגלו. כשהשתחרר מהאשפוז, הבין שיש לו בעיה. הוא התקשה לזוז על כיסא גלגלים. הוא לא יכול לחיות בדירה שכורה לבדו, ללא עזרה.
הבת שלנו שלחה לנו וואטסאפ שמחפשים בית כחייל בודד שנפצע. כתבתי לה בטח, לא שאלתי את יאיר, לא התייעצתי עם אף אחד. במחשבה באמת שזה חייל בודד שבא מאמריקה, ובבוא היום אנחנו נבוא לגבות את החוב בחזרה, וניסע כל המשפחה אליהם לאמריקה לטיול.
במקום איזה ג'וש או פול ממיאמי הגיע אליהו מירושלים, ולא לשבוע, גם לא לחודש. לא דבר פשוט לשום משפחה, בטח לא למשפחה עם שלוש בנות, אז בנות 10 עד 18.
אוקיי, it's a very long article.
So can you tell us a bit about
Ellie? Well, the thing is that the thing that we found out about this guy was that he didn't know anything because he never went to school. He went to some kind of a yeshiva for a few years. He didn't learn English or mathematics or geography, anything. And he was then hanging in the streets. And when he came to us, he didn't know anything about anything. So we started teaching him stuff and we sent him to some kind of school and he did his high school in 1 year.
And this project for a long time.
And now he finished his BA. He has a BA in the University of Reichman in Tel Aviv, Herzliya actually. So we're very proud of him. The project is like, it's an amuta.
It's an NGO.
Yeah, that is called on the name of Michael Levine, who was a soldier from America who came to Israel and died in Lebanon. And on his name, his parents started this organization. And Drorit, my wife, started the Israeli part of it because there's so many Israeli soldiers that need help, who come from Orthodox families or problematic families, and they take care of them, thousands of soldiers. So we're going to put the link for donations also in the link wherever. So that's the story of Eli Sofer,
who's still actually part of your family.
Yeah, he now has a girlfriend, and he has a flat in Petah Tikva, and he's now working and everything. He has a car, driving license, swimming. He's doing Ironman. He's a huge sports guy, very successful in sports. And he's part of the family. He comes to Shabbat dinners with us.
Have you ever met his family?
No, he has no connection to his family. Sadly enough.
So we're transitioning again. We're doing, like, I think you might have noticed that this goes in many different directions with Yair. And we're going to see a clip here that is, I'd say, almost highly relevant and quite amusing. You might recognize
the
guy that Yair is going to meet in this video. It's under a 2-minute clip.
So I've talked before.
You want to say before, so well, I'll stop.
Part of the show that I was talking about before, which is called Ahorei HaChadashot, every season, when the season ended, we used to do like kung fu karate short film, which was like me going with all the talents of the channel or the other channel, the competition, and do like a film of a karate and the kung fu. And apparently in this season, we invited a guy who was on the other channel. He was the host of another show. His name is also Yair. And since then, he left television, became a politician, started a new party called Yesh Atid, and yesterday became the actual prime minister of Israel, Yair Lapid. So we show you the film that we do a few years ago when he was not.
When he was not prime minister,
exactly.
This is Yair versus Yair.
Any questions?
Okay.
Yeah, the next thing was see you in the next season. Then, since then, he became prime minister. Yeah.
Yeah. So, one question: are you really fighting in this clip, and what fighting forms does each of you come from?
Well,
your tradition.
First of all, it's not the real fighting; it's close. I mean, the thing is coming like this. He's doing karate. He's black belt in karate. I was doing something called Sun Kwan Mu, which is a Korean martial arts system. And what was the other question? And we're very close, very
still?
Friendly. Yeah. And we meet every Friday morning, five, six guys, and talk about
politics.
Exactly. But don't tell anybody, it's a secret.
It's a secret. So This Friday morning, now that he's become prime minister, are you still going to meet?
I'm not sure, but maybe he will come over here and we'll do it here or at his house because the security is huge. He has tons of people surrounding him. You can't talk to him. So we have to go to a house or something.
So is your move into politics next move?
No way. No way. It's not for me. I'm into arts. Writing, music. I'm not suitable for politics at all.
So I want to open up for questions. You can put them in the chat. We have a few minutes before I also show our ending clip. I think one question we had was, how did you come to choose the faucet rather than any other tool?
Because of this stickiness, because, you know, I didn't find anything that sticks like this. So that's the reason.
That was the reason.
Yeah.
And one moment, I'm just going to check what are the questions that are coming in. In terms of the lyrics for your band's songs, were you writing all the lyrics?
Most of them, yeah. Most of the lyrics were written by me, yeah.
Yeah, and the composition?
Some of them by me, and most of them by Yair Nitzani, who is a very well-known musician in Israel, has his own solo career and a friend of mine for 45 years already.
There's a question here about a song that we didn't show, Hashem Tamid. I think that to tell the story of that song would take, I think, half an hour.
This song is also from that show, the radio show. Hashem Tamid is an Arabic character.
Yeah, we didn't show it. So I think
it's not so politically correct these days to do imitations of an Arabic guy, but the song was huge. It became a gold and platinum record. I have it over here. So Hashim Tamid gave me a platinum status. It was a huge hit. The whole country was singing the song, and I still do it on shows.
We'll send you.
It's a rap song.
It's actually the first Israeli rap song. We'll send you the clip in the follow up, and obviously all many other things. And I know you're touring in the U.S. a little.
I'm talking about coming on October, November, maybe for 2-3 weeks to do some shows. Comedies to speak about humor, Israeli humor. I'm going to university in New York, and I'm going to show to perform in front of Israelis in Arizona.
So it's mostly in Hebrew. Does your Hebrew humor translate to English?
Well, I haven't tried it yet because I always talk about stories about the Israeli stuff. But maybe I'll come also to Orange County to see you guys.
So I want to end with a clip. It's a song Yair also wrote. This clip is beautiful because it also has all the English translation and in sign language.
Exactly.
It became a kind of anthem. And as far as I remember from the stories, you wrote it when you were half asleep.
Yeah, I was very tired. And that was after a long filming day of a movie. This song is from a movie. And it was a long day. And in the middle of the night, after finishing the shooting, I went to sleep and the director called me, Avi Nesher, very, very famous director. And he said, listen, we are filming tomorrow morning the main title song of the movie. And we need your help because we don't have the lyrics to the song. Please write the lyrics now. And I was in my bed sleeping. And I started writing. He was playing me the music on the phone, and I was writing and sending him pieces of the song. And in the morning, I remember there was something creative happened at night. I didn't remember what. And the song became huge, huge, huge. It's my biggest hit, I think. We're talking about royalties. Okay. The singer and the composer is Meir Banai, who wrote the music, and he's singing also. So it was nice seeing you guys.
We'll say goodbye after this clip. You can see the words too and in sign language.
שומע את מה שבלב ורואה עתיד וחושב תמיד שהכוונה נותנת אמונה ורואה עתיד וחושב תמיד שהכוונה נותנת אמונה ואם רק נסתכל אם לא נבהל ונראה לעולם שביחד כולם אז יחד כן הלכת יחד כן הלכת יחד אל האור זה הזמן שיחד ואיתך ביחד לאור
Seattle.
Thank you.
שהכנס.
Okay, so I think someone just asked about the link to donate.
I put it in
again, just change it to everyone.
Everyone, okay. I gave it to somebody okay. specific.
If someone asked for the...
Where's the everyone? Bechol, yeah.
Everyone. Okay, so okay. Thanks, Nurit, for asking us for the link to donation. Yair is now putting it in the chat. It's for the NGO helping lone soldiers in Israel. Thank you, everyone. It was lovely to see you. I'm excited to send you like such a crazy bunch of viewing stuff from music to satire to other things. And
I enjoyed it very much. Thank you,
Yair. Shirel.
Thank you, everybody, for attending. And I see you next time or in America, wherever.
Or
the Tislam show when you come to Israel or when we come to play America.
Yes. Okay. Thank you, everyone. Have a good day, good afternoon, or good night, wherever you are. See you in our future programs. Bye.